tonight is also a very special night, one long overdue, by my measure anyway. It has been 9 years since Robert Storr was here for Tuesday evenings. Now, I was corrected that he came for a glass tire panel, which was how long ago, Rainey?
6 years ago.
Okay, still too long. But the reason I say it's too long, well, because it is, but also because in 1997, I started having Rob about every 3 years, and then I thought, okay, I've got to at least stretch it out to five, and I think this we've decided this might be the fifth time he's been here. So, we are making up for lost time tonight because it's been 9 years, by my count, with the exception of him being here for the panel. Rob Storr is one of the most, if not the most, clear and rigorous thinkers I have ever encountered, an opinion that I happen to share with many much more credible than myself. I like introducing him as a painter first, a painter with an MFA from the School of Art of the Art Institute of Chicago, who found his way into the museum world as senior curator of painting and sculpture at the MoMA, and into academia as the first Rosalie Solow Professor of Modern Art at the Institute of Fine Arts, NYU, and then as Dean of Yale University School of Art from 2006 to 2016, where he is still a professor of painting, and on an international stage in the highly esteemed position of curator and really overall directorship of the 2007 Venice Biennale. He has curated and published catalogs for numerous exhibitions, including monographic shows on Elizabeth Murray, Gerhard Richter, Tony Smith, Bruce Nauman, and Robert Ryman. That's to name a few. In April 2016, he was awarded the insignia of Officer of the Order of Arts and Letters by the French Ambassador to the U.S. And I have to note that I just learned that that recently he's been given a Guggenheim to write his memoir, which has me note that every time he's come in the past, Rob's come in the past, he's talked about artist, maybe an artist in our collection or an artist in an exhibition. This time I've convinced him to talk about Rob Storr. So in a way, we're kind of the sketch for this memoir that's to come. As a renowned author and critic, he has been a contributing editor at Art in America since 1981. He regularly contributes to exhibition catalogs and art publications such as Art Forum, Frieze, Marquette, and Art Press. His most recent publication, Intimate Geometries, The Work and Life of Louis Bourgeois, was released to much critical acclaim this past February. As noted in the announcement for tonight's event, Rob is here tonight to talk about, quote, learning on the job as a way of life during a period of extraordinarily complex, rapid, and far-flung changes in the art world. Now a polycentric, culturally diverse, and ever-morphing economic and politic alternate reality, as well as the abiding values that draw people to art and into an art community primarily inhabited by makers of various kinds, in what he is calling many hats, one head, the accidental curator. Please join me in welcoming Rob Storr.
Okay, this is gonna be a kind of extemporaneous talk. I've thought about it, and there are lots of images, and we may not get to all of them. But to keep it lively, I thought that was probably the best way to do it. First of all, I would not have done this under most circumstances, but Terry and I have this long back and forth, and she asked in the nicest possible way at a moment when I was really vulnerable. So, But I'll say something quickly at the beginning about the issues entailed and then go on. I am no more modest. This is the first slide we're going to keep it for. I am no more modest than anybody else. I don't really know anybody who's that modest. If you give people a chance at a dinner table or wherever, they tend to talk about themselves. But I think there are codes involved in what I've done professionally. And the codes include things like curators should not get out in front of artists. Exhibitions are not like Hollywood movie, you know, David Selznick presents, and then, you know, after that you list the artists as the stars. In fact, the more important thing than the artist is the art. And what curators should be doing is operating like magazine editors who select things that they bring to the attention of the reader that the reader they may then make up their own mind what they think about them. So, in the interests of not getting ahead of my artists or getting most certainly ahead of the art, I've tended to stay back. And this proved a liability in the highly competitive curatorial world of the last 20 years, where being the star curator was actually what it seemed to be all about for many of my colleagues. And they didn't like being reminded of the fact that maybe there were other ways of looking at this. So it's been a very contentious position to take, but I've taken it nonetheless, and I've stuck to it. So to come here and talk about myself is not really my favorite thing to do, but I have done so again because Terry said yes, and also because there are things to tell. And just in terms of my way of thinking about this memoir, there's a wonderful scene in Blade Runner where Rutger Hauer is dying. And he says, I have seen things at the edge of the galaxy. And then he goes on and on, like, it's very beautiful. And there's rain and it's, you know, it's the end of the world. That's the end of his world. And I kind of figured that I'm in the same position, that I have seen things other people have not seen. And the things are interesting. The fact that I have seen them is my good fortune. If I can convey them to other people, then that is my duty. It's not to talk about myself, but rather to talk about experience of the world that I have been lucky to have. There's another writer who's had an impact on me, who is a writer from Senegal, named Amadou Hapateba, who wrote a long and very good autobiography. And his phrase from that book is written on the walls of Gorée prison in just outside of Dakar, which is one of the principal places whence slaves were sent to the New World. And it says, when a man dies, a library burns. And if you think about all the writers and so on of recent years that have, you know, Borges or Pessoa or any number of writers of the modernist tradition who rather saw themselves as repositories of ideas, people's personas, et cetera, rather than as the authorial, you know, dominant presence in their work. Then that is another part of the way I think about things. Now, the other thing is what's happened to curation in general, and this is bottle is here. I saw this in a shop in the Hamptons. I've seen the word curator used on real estate deals in Manhattan. Apartment buildings are collections of apartments curated by some whatever it is. So we've gone from the exalting, over-exalting of the curator to the utter debasement, because now everybody wants to be one. When I started being a curator, it wasn't such a big deal. There were some big name people out there. There were people whose work I knew and respected, but it wasn't a sexy thing to do. I have two daughters, we have two daughters, and one of them talks about curating, it was a verb, which it's not, it's a noun. and anyway, talk about it as if that's what everybody does. Anyway, so this guy here is here to remind me and to remind you of the foolishness of what has happened to the role of curator in recent years, and to bring it down a few notches. Again, what curators do is they bring things that they think are worth your attention, have proven worth their attention, to the attention of others, and then they get out of the way. Okay, so having said that, I will now do some other things with this. And as you know, in certain kinds of businesses, particularly the entertainment industry, there's such a thing as a me wall. And the me wall is where the person whose enterprise it is photographed with lots of famous people. And you're about to have a little bit of that here. And the reason for this is simply to say that actually it is a world where you meet remarkable people. And they are many of them remarkably unpretentious, like Bruce Nauman or Richard or any number of people. So if I put them up here, it's not to say, look at me, look at me, look at me, but actually to say there is a community of artists and of writers and of curators and of museum people and of staff members and of art handlers and that really form the core of the production of exhibitions. And it's a remarkably easygoing, direct, straightforward thing. Many of my friends are art handlers from MoMA. I have better relations with the art handlers than I have with my fellow curators in most cases, for reasons I needn't go into, but you can guess. I was an art handler for a while, and I was actually an art handler briefly at MoMA for a while. So I'm trying to paint a picture of a world where people know each other and talk about each other. And when I'm in classes and teaching to my students in whatever discipline it may be, I often first name artists because I know them. It seems rather odd to talk about Mr. Johns when actually he is Jasper Johns and I know him as Jasper, so I'm gonna do that here. This is not name dropping. It's just to say this is a context in which people really do have direct relationships, complicated sometimes, sometimes remarkably simple. But I would like to demystify the art world as much as I can, again, to put accents on what really matter, which is the work. This is half of my library. Now, I'm dyslexic. I'm pretty seriously dyslexic. Not the worst, Chuck Close is much worse, but not so good either. And I learned how to read, but I did with great pain. And one of the things I did was I bought lots and lots of books. I ended up working in the book business, because I was partially raised by a couple, two women, who ran a bookstore who taught me to read. And so I was around books a lot even when I couldn't read them. And by the time I could read them, I sort of felt they were the safe place to be. So if I want to do psychoanalysis, I would say I built myself the perfect safe place, lots and lots and lots of books. But the other side of this is that the work of the curator is to look, to consider, to weigh, to think, to read, to look behind things and so on. And books in the art world, as you know, appear and disappear very, very fast. If you see a book that you want to buy on a shelf someplace, buy it, because it's very likely that you will not find it again for a long time, if ever. And if you do find it again, it'll be, it'll be half your annual income to buy it. So I recommend to art students and to artists, please, rather than having something else, get the best information you can and the best package you can get in. And this is just, as I say, part of the library. This is another piece of my history. This is a mural by David Alfaro Siqueiros in Mexico City, and I actually painted part of that. In the 1970s, when I was, the 1960s really, when I was on the left in this country, I went to school in France in May 68. I was part of the student revolt, came back to the States, Chicago Convention, you name it, went on and on and on. And at a certain point, I decided, okay, let me make some revolutionary art. And I had a friend, a college friend, whose friends included Elizabeth Catlett, who's an African-American artist who took exile in Mexico during the McCarthy era and who taught at the Academia San Carlos in Mexico City. And I said to my friend, you know, I really am interested in what Siqueiros does. And he said, it's easy, I can get you to meet him. And so, long story short, I ended up in Mexico City working for a summer, painting on this mural, which is the Poliforum in Siqueiros in Mexico City. Now, it is one of the least successful of all murals that Siqueiros ever did. And one of the things I learned about political art is this is not the way to do it. But I learned a lot in the process, and I got to know him quite well. So this is me at the Poliforum, and the blonde guy in the back, with Siqueiros when he was in his 70s. And these were other members of the painting team and of his household staff and so on and so forth. It was a very, very interesting experience. It was a, in some ways, disillusioning experience, but not in a negative sense. It simply removed from some illusions. He was a figure of many contradictions, who did some remarkable things, and he did some dastardly things as well. And being close to him for a period of time, we both spoke French, so we did it all in French. My Spanish was not very good. He liked me because I understood where he was coming from in terms of all kinds of historical things that most of his other associates at that time didn't know. But I learned basically the history of the mural movement, of Stalinism of that period, because he was an arch Stalinist, and of what happened to the left in one of its worst periods by just talking to this guy and by meeting all the people around him. This is another person who has been a major influence in my life. This is Louise Bourgeois, and this is me with some MoMA staff members, Jerry Neuner, and Karen senior moment. Come to me in a second. And this is at the installation of a show that I did at MoMA, the first major show I did called Dislocations. And I met Louise by accident as an art handler. We got to be very good friends very fast. I was enfolded into her world almost immediately. Again, because I spoke French, I was one of the relatively few people who spoke French to her all the time. And she kept drifting in and out of French and English, so if you wanted to really follow her thought, you had to be able to move with her whichever language she chose. And in my first show at the MoMA, I included her, Ilya Kabakov, Bruce Nauman, Adrian Piper, Chris Burden, Sophie Kahl, and I'm forgetting somebody, but it'll come to me. Anyway, and Louise was at this point installing her piece, and we were all sitting in the galleries. Now, the particular piece she made was one of the last things paid for by the NEA. And it was this huge sort of hydraulic machine made of two gas tanks that pistoned in and out of each other all the time, paid for by the NEA. A copulation machine paid for by the NEA. But she wasn't happy with it, so she went out and bought herself a flashing police light, the kind that you put on the top of your car. And when Bruce came in to look at his piece, he said, ah, you gotta watch that woman. She upstaged him. This is Philip Johnson, who is another side of this story of the 1930s. Philip Johnson, who was actually a Nazi sympathizer, actively, who was nearly charged with treason, but who was the best friend in many, many ways of Alfred Barr, the founder of the Museum of Modern Art. And he was the completely amoral, completely opportunistic, enormously witty, smart, and untrustworthy man. And he was a major figure at the moment when I arrived, and he very early on befriended me because he thought I had what it took to do the things that the modern used to do. So in as much as on the one side, I had a friendship with a guy who was actually part of the assassination plot against Trotsky. In this case, I had a friendship, sort of, and I installed his collection ultimately, with a man who went into Poland with the Nazi army. When people talk about the contradictions of the art world, they have never been less complicated than they are now. The art world is not a pure place. You will not find situations which are not tainted by all of these things. And the task of somebody who's a curator in this role is not to steer clear of politics, but to make sure that your primary role, again, is to get art that is of value to the greatest number of people possible, that they can make up their own minds about it. And you will, in fact, sup with the devil. Maybe several different devils, sometimes a table full of them. That's just this case. It doesn't mean that you have sold out to them. It doesn't mean that you agree with them. They know you probably don't agree with them. And Philip came to me at the time I opened Art Spiegelman's show, all the drawings for Mouse, and made a very nasty and rather anti-Semitic crack about how I'd gone over to the other side. But in any case, this this tells you something about the vicissitudes of being a curator. This is another show that I did with Bruce Nauman. That's Harry Zeman in the background, and that's an art handler who worked with us installing the show. And this is the kind of community I'm talking about, where all there is equals. This is Harry Zeman and I in Moscow at the time of the organization of the first Moscow Biennale. Again, for little incidental things, we're near the Kremlin, and we are very near Lenin's tomb. Our guide was a Ukrainian curator. We wanted both to see Lenin's tomb. She refused to cross into that territory, only because there was a statue of Stalin there, and Stalin, of course, had decimated the populations of Ukraine, and she refused to be anywhere near it. So again, you enter into this zone which is politicized from the get-go, and people who believe that there is no politics in art are deluding themselves. The question is how you handle yourself in relation to it. This is also a political situation. This is me with Gerhard Richter and Katerina Manchanda, who's a very good curator who's now out in Seattle. And this is us working on the Richter show that I did at Modern in 2002. And Gerhard is nothing but a sort of a catalogue of all the ambivalences one could possibly have in relation to German history, which is why his art is so interesting and why his self-consciousness about all those contradictions is so remarkable. This is me with Sheila Hicks in Paris. This is the courtyard where Giacometti had his studio, or where he has his archives. And Sheila, of course, is a sign of longevity in the art world. She has been around for a very, very, very long time, and she is thriving in her 90s. This is me with Bob Ryman. This is an exhibition that we did together at the Modern, his major retrospective at that time. This is me when I was young, sort of. This is me with Jasper and another show I did on maps, where Jasper, one of Jasper's maps was in the show alongside one of the maps of Kim Jones. And Kim Jones was somebody that Jasper had met at Gemini ULE, in Los Angeles, and they were friends. And so the two of them together had this dialogue, if you will. And one of the pleasures of this show is to put one of Jasper's things once up against one of Kim's things. This is me with Ron Kitai, R.B. Kitai, who's an artist about whom I have very mixed feelings, but whose good stuff is as good as it gets and whose bad stuff is far better than most people's bad stuff. But he's a case of an art historical figure who should be more prominent because he was involved in doing things that we would now call postmodern long before there was that category. And he once made a statement to the effect of, some pictures have books and some books have pictures. And he worked both sides of that line. And he did facsimiles of book covers. And among other things, he did facsimiles of book covers of Trotsky on terrorism, which Trotsky approved of. So if you think of Cicado's killing Trotsky, or trying to anyway, he was trying to kill a man who would just as easily have killed him. And another one was Ezra Pound, The ABCs of Reading, which is one of my favorite books, but Ezra Pound was a despicable fascist and anti-Semite. Here again, we get back and back and back into the history of this. So Kitai, who is Jewish, made works on that and did reproductions of the covers of these books to evoke all of these factors in his thinking about art. And although I, again, am not a big fan of his, I am a sufficient fan of his that I think he should be written back into history. And my view of curatorial practice is largely to write a more textured version of what really happened by collecting in exhibitions and catalogs and so on, than simply making big speeches about the prejudices in the art world of which we're all too well aware. The thing is to act, is to take institutions and make them do what they should do, rather than stand outside of them and rant. This is me with somebody else you might know in the background. That's Jeff Koons. In the foreground, that's Cicciolina. Again, contradictions, ironies. This is the first showing of The Puppy, and it was shown at a castle in Arlesen, which is near Kassel, which is where Documenta was that year. Now, Jeff was not chosen for Documenta, and so he decided to do something rather clever, which was to upstage it, to make everybody who went to Documenta come all the way to Arlesen to see his piece, and they did. And there it was in front of the castle, and it's this big, flower-friendly puppy, blah, blah, blah. The thing that he missed is that Arlesen, the castle in Arlesen, is where the archives of the SS is held, at least in grounds nearby it. So that in this sign of total happiness is, there is also the shadow of the worst that people have done in the 20th century. And to not understand that is an indication of where his art runs into real trouble for me. This is Kusama, who's now feted everywhere. At this time, you can see she was still rather haunted. This is in the studio next to the asylum where she took residence for about 30 years after leaving the United States. This is me with Louise again. This is me being welcomed by Leo Castelli, who actually didn't like me one little bit. And again, I'll tell you a story. This is like name dropping, but it's a good story. I was an art handler for a while, and I worked for a corporate collection, and I used to move art around in their warehouse. And I would be the guy holding the painting, while the person who owned the collection would be talking about maybe selling it to Leo or selling it back to somebody else. When I was announced as a curator by Kirk Varnedoe, who picked me out of the chorus line, he immediately got a call from Leo saying, I don't know this young man. I'd love to meet him. Will you set up a lunch for us? And so he invited us to Da Silvana, which was a very good Italian restaurant near his gallery. In the meantime, in 1968, when I was very young, I had met Jasper Johns at a party and talked to him briefly. Then in 1980, that was in 68, in 1980, I met him through Stephen Green. And Stephen Green was a painter who had been a friend of Guston's, who was a person of consequence. He was Frank Stella's teacher. And Stephen invited me over one time with my wife to have lunch, and there was Jasper. So we had this meeting at lunch, and we met again through a lot of other people. So Leo sets up this whole thing to impress the young curator at MoMA who he's never met, and to make sure that he sort of got his hands on me. And so I arrive at the table with Kirk, And Leo jumps up and says, oh, we've never met. And I just said very noncommittally, oh, yes, we have. And then immediately, Jasper jumps up and says, hi, Rob. And so his whole game was completely blown. And he never forgave me for that. But in fact, it was necessary because one cannot be the creature of dealers if one's going to be a curator. One can be friendly with dealers. One must be practical and do business with them. But nobody should be sort of the prisoner of their friendships with people on the commercial side. The commercial side is what it is, and the people on the non-commercial side are doing something different. This is me with Meyer Shapiro, the great American art historian, and that's Charles Cajori in the middle. And this is at the studio school where I taught for a number of years, in which I ran for half a year with Jackie Bruckner. And Meyer was one of the truly great art historians of modern era in the United States. He's the person who introduced semiotics, Freud, Marx to American art history. And he was in his 80s. He was also, by the way, a practicing artist, a pretty good one. And so in this, again, this in this sort of social context, these people are real. And I learned a great deal from him. I learned a lot from Leo Steinberg, who was another member of this very small group. This is me with Emilio Ambas, and this is the exhibition of Kerry James Marshall recently. Emilio is an architect, a wonderfully dandified, acerbic, worldly man. I like people like that, and I like him very much. But I particularly like this photograph because the thought bubbles in Kerry James Marshall pavement have become thought bubbles of Emilio Ambas. If you could only read his mind. This is me with Nobuyoshi Araki, the Japanese photographer, who spent an entire night trying to get me naked with prostitutes so he could take my picture. It didn't work, but we had an interesting evening. Now, this is a little personal stuff. These are two portraits, one of me and one of my wife, Rosamund Morley, who is a musician, musician of early and Renaissance music, Baroque and Renaissance music, who was playing at Carnegie Hall when I was schlepping paintings for minimum wage. She had the first success in our family, and we lived off of her income for many years. She is a remarkable person. She's English and Canadian. She was not at all prepared for the life that we fell into, and has rolled with the punches remarkably well. And I'll be a little bit more over here, but these are pictures that Philip painted of each one of us. And then gave to us. And Philip was somebody I admired a great deal as an artist, so I was absolutely thrilled that we should have this opportunity. This is me and Ross together at an exhibition. This is the wedding announcement that we had. This is a peasant and his beloved done by juror. And I had found a facsimile of this from East Germany that we used for the cover of our wedding announcement. And 2 years ago, it came up on the market for, I think, about $8,000. And so I bought the real one. I finally had enough money to do that. So I gave that to her for a wedding anniversary. This is a picture that was painted by Catherine Gilcher, who is a painting restorer, who makes paintings based on paintings that are liked by the subject. And she'll put your head on somebody else's painting. Lowry Sims, who is this wonderful, big scale African-American curator at the Met for many years and then at the Studio Museum and lots, she had herself painted as Napoleon, sitting in Napoleonic pose, but with Huey Newton's woven chair, a shotgun, and a spear. And other people had things. Bob Rosenblum had himself painted as an incredibly handsome French officer with a brocaded jacket and so on. So Catherine asked what we would like, and I said I would like this particular painting, which is Manet listening to his life playing music. Now, it was painted by Degas, the original, what Manet's wife is doing is playing the piano. The artist, to say Manet, did not like it, and so he cut off the section with his wife playing the piano. And so Catherine cleverly restored it, adding the gamba in lieu of the piano. So now we have the only complete version of a great Degas masterpiece. This is one of the first things I bought when I was at the Modern. It was something that did not belong in the painting and sculpture collection per se. And that was a big issue at the Modern in those days, and is a big issue in many museums still. For reasons that are not entirely foolish, but nonetheless, it was a cause of much missed opportunity at the Modern. My justification was that this was based on painting, so that the painting conventions within this photograph are as good as actual liquid paint. And I did this with John Baldessari and numbers of others. So there, one of the roles of a curator is to change the way in which people think, not just outside the museum, but within the museum, to make the case to one's colleagues that old categories may be good for old works, but they're not necessarily good for new works, and you have to rethink everything all the time. This was a work that I bought also, which made some heads sort of scratch. This is a work by Jörg Immendorf, and it's the German flag with a nonsense word little, which was his sort of word for Dada, which is his own coinage. And he made this block twice, painting it with a flag, and then he walked it like a dog around the German Bundestag in Bonn. Now, as I said, there were two versions of this, and they were both on the market. One of them was the version that he made that was, if you will, the one he kept, and the other one was the one he actually walked. But he was busted by the cops for defamation of the flag, and it was confiscated from him, and he had to get it back later. Now, I could have bought the unblemished one, but in fact, this one is the one that records the performance, so that's why I bought this one. This is a work by Elizabeth Murray, one of the last paintings she painted. I made a retrospective of Elizabeth about 3 years before she died. She was already very ill by the time we got it started. She's one of the first people I proposed for an exhibition at MoMA, and I was there for 12 years. And it took a very long time to get it up and running, but we did. And then I got her to Venice, and I took her to Venice. And I showed her in Venice, in the Venice Biennale. But this is a case of somebody whose work was known by everybody, respected by some people. Kirk was a big fan of her work. Kirk Varnedoe, that is, my boss. But many people did not like it, because this kind of work is not housebroken. It does not sit well behind a sofa. It will not stay in its place, and in some cases it comes way out of the wall and almost assaults the viewer. So again, one of the things you have to do is you have to say, okay, if Frank Stella can make big aggressive work, why can't Elizabeth Murray? And if Elizabeth Murray does it in ways which are more radical than Frank Stella, and I'll get into that sometime when I'm doing a lecture on Elizabeth, but just take my word for it, they are more radical. Why is everybody so squeamish about them? And I think there are many kinds of reasons why they're squeamish, but the point of advocacy as a curator is to put other people's money where your mouth is. And then to make that work available to the general viewer, as I said, that they may make up their own minds. And this was a very popular show of an artist that was not very popular among the patron class, and is still not. Shortly after this exhibition, you could buy Elizabeth Murray's for a song, which means that it's not true that museums make the market. The market is made by many other things than the museums, and increasingly not by museums. So the advocacy that you can do in a museum context is not simply to enhance the equity of collectors. It is actually to enhance awareness of artists, and even when you do that, they don't get rich. Some of them don't. This work by Louise Bourgeois, which was another early thing that I bought. It was one of the first installations to enter MoMA's collection. Probably the first is a work by Friedrich Kreisler. But anyway, this is a piece that is made out of old elements. These black things are old pieces of hers from the 40s that she cast in the rubber you use for tires. And it becomes this kind of memory box that you go into this place and you are surrounded by memories. This is another thing that I acquired, and this was a gift by Louise. This is called Fillette, which is the French for little girl. You wouldn't think it, but it is. And there are a series of sexual puns in this which are directly related to sexual puns made by Giacometti and Brancusi and others. Mademoiselle Pogani, which is a great piece by Brancusi, which the MoMA has, is one of these things where the masculine and feminine traits are, you know, conjured in such a way that you can't quite keep track of them. Now, this particular piece is hung on a hook, but it's not meant to be hung on a hook. Actually, it's meant to be cradled in your arms. It's a site-specific sculpture where the embrace of the viewer holder is the site. And the whole point is to destabilize the viewer holder's relationship to the destabilized gendering of this object. And it was a very, very radical piece when she made it in the 60s, and it is today still a very radical piece. There are several variations of this that have been done since, but this is the original one, and she gave it to the museum. And I was at Louise's house and said, well, what would you like to do? And she said, I think I'll give it in honor of Alfred Barr, who was a man she knew very, very well, and for whom actually she had a crush, on whom she had a crush. And then she thought for a minute, she said, no, I'll give it in memory of Alfred Barr. And she chuckled. This is another work I acquired. It's a part of another work I acquired. These are the Baader-Meinhof paintings of Gerhard Richter. This is a case of having just gone on a hunch. I was very impressed by these works when I saw them. They were shown at the Gray Art Gallery in New York. They were like nothing that had ever been done in this country. These are works about political ambivalence. They're paintings by a man who left the communist East to come to the West, who was never a radical at all, but who had some sympathies with the personalities of the people who were in the Baader-Meinhof group, in particular Ulrike Meinhof, who was his exact contemporary, and whose family had been anti-Nazis during the Nazi time, whereas his family was pro-Nazi, and he had actually been in Hitler Youth. So this is a work which raises all of these issues, and in America, nobody painted Sabine's Liberation Army, the SDS groups, and so on. Nobody did this thing in our country. Nobody took on the vicissitudes of the 1960s in quite such a successful way. So I thought that this is a work that would be great for MoMA. It belongs in the history of art, absolutely. And I went to him and I asked him, would he sell it when I found out that it actually was known by nobody? And he said, after reflection, he said, yes, he would. He said, I don't want to take it away from Germany. And he said, no, I think it's time that it left Germany, because in Germany, it is only understood in terms of positions that people take on these issues as if they were the same today. And this is art. This is a painting about many things, not just that. And that if it was another place where it was seen in the context of other art, it would be understood better, actually, after all, than it would be understood in Germany. That's why he let it go. And this is Ulrike Meinhof out of that cycle. This is Gerhard himself in one of his rare self-portraits. And this is a painting that I didn't acquire per se, but that I helped bring to MoMA. This is a painting that he made of the destruction of the World Trade Center. And it's important because the show that we did opened before the World Trade Center, which opened after the World Trade Center attack, and he was on his way to New York for an exhibition at his gallery in the year before. Ours was 2002, he came in 2001. And his plane was turned around and he was sent back first to Halifax, Nova Scotia, where he'd once taught, and then back to Germany. But this event had a profound effect on him. And you remember, this is a man who grew up in Nazi Germany. He grew up under the bombardments of the United States Air Force, Allied Air Force, and so on. He had very mixed feelings about this kind of violence. Not that he was for the violent, the people who did this, but he was aware that the United States had never felt the brunt of an attack like this ever, right? Not since our own Civil War. So to portray this kind of violence in a way that Americans would understand it differently than they were probably inclined to at the moment that it happened, and we live in Brooklyn, we saw this happen, was something he tried to do, and he did. So this painting was a gift by him and a friend to MoMA. This is a painting of, you can't really see it, this is a painting of Glenn Ligons. This is a painting of Yayo Kusama. MoMA didn't have a painting of Yayo Kusama's. It had works on paper, it had drawings, it had a lot of things, but it didn't have a painting. This is a painting by Philip Guston and another. These were gifts of the Guston's family, particularly his widow. The first book I wrote was a book on Guston. Kirk Varnedoe was very interested in Guston, so here were two curators in this museum attached to Guston as a principal artist. As a result, the museum was a beneficiary of this enormous gift. This is a work painted in Texas. This is in the Gulf country of Texas by Rackstraw Downs, who has been living in Texas on and off for many, many years. There was nothing like this at MoMA. There was no real realism at MoMA. There were bits and pieces of things from the 40s and 50s and so on and so forth, but American realism of mid-century was absent by and large because it was uncool, because it didn't follow the narratives of art history written by Greenbergs and others. And so this is a painting that I acquired for the museum to fill a blank, not just in terms of that artist, but a whole category of art. Direct observational realism in the age of photography. In a way, Richter's connected to that, but this is different because his is a critique of photography. This is the use of painting to rival photography. Now, there's a story attached to this, too. I put this painting on hold for, I think, 9 months. And it was really embarrassing because I couldn't raise the money. And it wasn't terribly expensive, but it wasn't cheap either, and it was certainly not to the taste of most of my committee members. Now, if you remember back to the photograph of Leo Castelli, there was a woman sort of laughing with her cigarette. That was Lily Auchincloss. And Lily Auchincloss was one of the most stylish women of her generation. Her father ran a perfume company that sold scents to all the major cosmetics firms, and she was a grand, grand person. She introduced Andy Warhol to Marcel Duchamp. And she came to all these meetings, and she would sneak off and smoke her cigarettes in the back corridor along with the staff and come back to the table and vote on things. And so I brought this painting in, and I sort of threw it on the mercy of the jury, which was the committee, if anybody would acquire it. And just before we went to the vote, and I had nothing in the bank, she just leaned over me and said, "I'll pay for it." Now, if you want to write predictive commentaries about the art world, think about that. What happens when the woman who introduced Andy Warhol to Marcel Duchamp pays for something as deliberately prosaic as this? This is another painting by another realist of this type, and this is Philip Perlstein, who painted my portrait. This is one where he paints a male nude in the presence of two African-American dolls. And it would be reasonable to suppose that these are minstrel dolls. And it would be reasonable to conjecture that there's a very unhealthy, or at least uncomfortable, dynamic between this white guy and those caricatured African-American figures. Problem. They're actually dolls made by African-Americans. And the whole point of Perlstein's work is to say that you see something that is described to you in meticulous detail, but you don't necessarily know what it is. Now, back in a minute, you'll see some more of this, but back in the day, Philip went to the Institute of Fine Arts where I taught. He was a student of art history, and he wrote his dissertation for Lopez Rey, who was the great historian of Velázquez, on none other than Francis Picabia. And he was interested in Picabia's perversities. He was interested in a lot of the things that Picabia did, so you have a kind of realist Dadaist in this situation, playing with the expectations of the viewer and using, again, this idea of truth to representation as the means to do it. You bring people in by saying, it's going to be, you know, just the facts, man. But the facts turn out to be extremely ambiguous and extremely provocative. This was painted at a time when the discourses of difference and otherness and politics of race and so on and so forth were coming to the fore. And here's an artist who was then in his 70s when he did this. He's now 90. This is an artist who is then in his 70s taking on these issues from an aesthetic vantage point that you would not have expected, or at least I did not expect, and doing it in a way that it makes issues that are not predictive come to the fore. Now, there's another painting. This is a painting by Philip Perlstein, which I also, with Kirk's help, acquired from the museum. This was painted in 1949, 50, maybe 51, by Philip Perlstein when he was the roommate of Andy Warhol. He also painted a dollar sign at that time. Philip Perlstein, again, was a very, very perverse, interestingly perverse, imagination. Painting, again, in a straightforward representational manner. But at this time, he was interested in the Italian Baroque. He'd been a grant to the American Academy in Rome. So, you know, this is Superman over Manhattan and dollar signs dancing in people's eyes. This is pop art before there was pop art. And to know that Philip and Andy were close, close friends all their lives. They both came from fairly ordinary families. Andy's was poor. Philip's was a little bit better off. And so Andy would come to Philip's house and do his homework on the table, and they would, you know, trade gags and do and so forth. So the unwritten art history of American art history is everywhere around us. And when you start dealing with objects, read chronologies carefully, listen to what people have to say about their lives, and just shut off the constant drone of theory. Not that there's nothing to be said for it, but it talks too much. and starts to listen to the particulars, then you learn other things. And the greatest historian of realism in this country, Linda Nochlin, said that is basically the rule of realism, that the abstract is about the general, the realist is about the particular. And the tyranny of the general over the particular is an aspect of all of our art. And it doesn't mean that we should now do the tyranny of the particular over the general. We should just sort of even up the balance a bit and realize that these are in dialogue and in contradiction with one another. Interestingly, not that there is an absolute truth to be had. This is an artist who was also not in MoMA's collection and now is. This is Jim Nutt. This is Jim Nutt too. Both of these are in the collection. Because in this case, I had to back and fill. I had to collect an early and a late so that people would know what had happened to him. But this is Jim Nutt, the old master Flemish painter. And this is Jim Nutt, the Midwestern nasty guy who did stuff that pop art didn't dare do. You know, like for perspiration shields and women's garments and things like that. Nothing that the pop artist had ever got down that low. This is a work by an artist from Africa, Sherry Samba, who is a so-called popular painter. That is to say, he paints signs for his neighborhood, and he also paints commentaries on politics. And this is about the exploitation of immigrant workers by the people who bring them in. This is a painting that was done in the early 90s, and this was one of the last things I acquired from MoMA. It was something that somebody had bought before I could, and he very generously gave it to us thereafter. But this is the beginning of the collecting of African contemporary art at MoMA. And there were some other things that came in at the same time, Mustafa Dime and others. But this was where MoMA began to turn a corner. But the truth of the matter is that MoMA had collected African art in the 60s. Alfred Barr had gone to Africa to collect it in the 60s. MoMA's history of looking at the world as a whole was admirable, and then somehow they lost the thread. And then much of what has been done since is to go back and pick up that thread and follow it to different places. This is a piece I actually gave to MoMA. It cost me all $100. This is It'll come to me. He does very funny sculptures. Anyway, but you'll see these are... Tom Friedman, yes, this is Tom Friedman, whose work I showed in a project show, and this was a piece made by an old-fashioned digital printer, and you could have one for $100, so I got one for $100 and gave it to MoMA. This is a work by Norman Lewis, one of two that I bought. Alfred Barr, MoMA's founding director, had been on a panel with Norman Lewis and Ad Reinhardt and Bill de Kooning and all those people in 1950. And it collected a drawing and a print, but there was no painting. Now, Norman Lewis's best friend was Ad Reinhardt. Norman Lewis was somebody who was in this world as a teacher, and many of the people that became the next generation of geometric painters studied with him. But he was a figure who was sort of present and not present. And I figured this is ridiculous. If you're going to have a proper history of modernism in this country or worldwide, you should have a decent representation of this artist's work. So I was able to get two of these for a relatively reasonable price and two quite different ones. This is one. This is an exceptional work. Anybody's guess? Yes, you're right. Good. You get star, gold star. This is the only painting of its kind other than one other which has recently surfaced, which is purple. But this is Ryman before he was so-called a painter of white. But the point is, he's never been a white painter. He's been a painter of painter, and white has always been a color. It recommends itself to him because of its neutrality, but there's always color underneath, or almost always, and there is always the color of the color that he does. But anyway, this is a very early Ryman painting, so this is a piece of Bruce Nauman's that I hunted down. This was in the collection of Ed Keenholz. It's made out of crankcase oil, tin foil, and felt. It was rolled up, and it was oozing oil. It leaves a stain wherever it goes. And what the holes are is the circumference of somebody's waist, wrists, and ankles. So this is actually the height of a man and bits and pieces of the man's body in section, cross-section, made out of this funky material. This is humanist sculpture. This is Mike Kelly. This is the second thing I bought when I was at MoMA. And this is an early rug piece. And this is one of the first gifts I got. This is Felix Gonzalez Torres. This is called Placebo. It's the weight of Felix and his lover in a kind of candy that is sort of bittersweet, grapefruit, hard outside, soft inside. Beautiful, shiny paper. And this was a gift of one of his collectors. And the principle of this is that you lay this out on the floor in the proportions of the weight of the two men, the first of whom had died of AIDS already by the time this was made, the second of whom, the artist, died thereafter. And people come into the museum and they can't resist, they reach down. And that's the whole point. He wanted to take away the look, don't touch thing. He wanted to take away the idea that the piece was absolutely unique and could never be reproduced. In fact, it must be reproduced. Anybody who owns a Felix Gonzalez Torres must be prepared to pay for the cost of replenishing it when it is used up, and when it is used up by the viewer, toucher, whatever it is. And then this candy is bittersweet. I won't go into the semiotics of that, but maybe you can guess. But in any case, people pick it up. They violate the commercial relationship or the economic relationship of the museum, and then you have a whole world of people sucking. That is institutional critique. This is a Richard Serra piece, which came in through Elaine Danheiser, who gave us a lot of stuff, including some more good pieces of Felix's. This is the piece that Felix did as a project show. Ann Umblin, who's currently a curator there, did this as a project show, and it was all over New York. And as you looked up from many places, there was this bed with the imprint of two bodies with no identification as to who those bodies were, what they were doing, anything. It was a completely open scene of intimacy to be filled by the imagination of the person who saw it. And this was done at the height of the AIDS hysteria. And this was a very brave thing to do because it was subtle. It whispered instead of shouted. It suggested everything and said nothing. It was not shy, but it invited viewers to project onto this what it is that they had in their minds, which is a political act. To invite people to do that is far more political than emblazoning a message which people will then agree or disagree with. And there's a role for that kind of work too, and Barbara Kruger plays the game of that very differently and very well. But what Felix did was, at a time of incredible antagonisms and fear, he created an inviting image to think about the unthinkable. Oh, sorry. I'm almost at the end of my time, and I've got tons of slides. What? Darn. I'll have to do it again. Anyway, this is the Ryman Show, which was my first major exhibition at the museum after I did Dislocations, which is another one, which is installation art, which is the one that had Louise and Bruce and all of them. And then this was another one. This is the Richter retrospective. This brings us to 2002, to 8 o'clock, and I can just click off things, or I can answer questions. But let me just quickly say one thing. Okay, I was at MoMA from 1990 to 2002. For a host of reasons, I decided I could not do the work there that I had started out to do. Kirk, my patron and supporter, had left. The environment was very, very different. And I thought, rather than just hold on to a job, I would just walk away from it without noise and go find something else to do. And the first thing I did was to work for the Institute of Fine Arts for, I guess it was 4 or 5 years, and taught in a school which taught art history. It was a very interesting experience, a very good experience in some ways, and a very discouraging one in others, because I would have students who would come to me and ask me to help support their scholarly work, and then would ask me about artists that they know I had written about, and artists in many cases, in almost all cases, that I actually knew, and then proceeded to write their dissertation proposals only citing the lists of critics that were then at the top of the October magazine star list. I realized at that point that art history had become such a guild system, and that in order to get into that guild, you had to play exactly to the powers in that guild. And I realized that a lot of the people who were ostensibly involved in institutional critique were involved in practices that were at least as questionable in their own field as anything that any of us in museums did. And I found it very inhospitable. I don't want to be a counterpuncher in an environment which sanctions that kind of thing. So at that point, I decided, okay, I'll try one other thing. And I was remarkably, Elizabeth Murray's house offered a chance to get the job at Yale. So I decided I'll go back to where I started. I'll go back to teaching art, which I had done all along. I'll go back to making art, which I hadn't done much, and I will proceed from there. Now, there's some slides of my work in here. There's some slides of my students' work. There's all kinds of stuff you won't get. But the basic narrative is that I took time out from my professional painter's life and painting teacher's life to do exhibitions. And I learned an enormous amount, and I met amazing people. But at a certain point, I realized that the world had so changed that the very things that made it attractive and possible in the 90s had disappeared, that the art world had become so commercial, so politicized, and so vicious, basically, that it wasn't possible to do it. And you can try as you might to set a different example. If the rest of the world doesn't hear you, doesn't want you, and I'm not complaining, but I mean, if they don't back you up is what I'm really saying, it's almost impossible to do that. So I'm now trying to find whether we can constitute a different way of doing things by fishing people out of all these different domains and saying, we've heard the argument for one kind of practice, we've heard the argument for the other kind of practice, how about we just do something different? So that's my spiel.
Okay, if there are questions, we're going to use these because it works better for the podcast. I'm going to ask.
Sure.
These are just things that I bought for people. I mean, not for people, but for museums. This is Kansas City Art Institute, Kansas City, Nelson Atkins. Richard Tuttle. Richard Felix Gonzalez Torres, Louise Bourgeois.
So questions?
The power of the purse.
Can you say something about your childhood?
My childhood? what would you like to know?
How you came to be a painter?
I came to be a painter again because I was dyslexic. When I was in school, the only thing I could do was draw. So that's what I did. I drew and drew and drew and drew. I was frustrated at what I was drawing. I was getting all kinds of strange input from people that I didn't really want to hear. So after a certain point, I decided, this is a piece of business that I'll have to attend to. But at a certain point, I cracked reading and writing, and I went after it with a vengeance. I had a family that was almost every one of them is a reader and or writer. So I figured, okay, I will learn how to master this other thing and then come back to painting. That's basically what I did. After college, I went to art school. And after I was in art school, I started to make my way in the world just as a part-time teacher, as a lot of people do, and making paintings and so on. And when Kirk hired me, I had just been given a job, a tenure-track job at Tyler School of Art in Philadelphia. And it had been arranged for me by some people who taught there who had been very supportive. And I felt that I couldn't, basically back out on the commitment that they had made to me and that I had made to them, so I turned him down. The year after that, he came back again. He said, now, you've honored your end of the bargain by teaching this year. Would you consider again? And at that point, I asked around and I said, what do you think I should do? And I asked lots of different people. I asked Leanne Gollard, for example, who's a very close friend. And I particularly asked Felix. And Felix, I said, what happens if I cross this line? Will I forever be, the establishment? And he said, no, it'd be really nice to have one of us on the inside. So that's kind of the way I took it, and that's kind of what I did.
So I get a very strong sense of your aesthetic as the aesthetic of the throne.
The what?
The throne, THROWN, throne.
The throne.
What's the aesthetic of the throne?
Well, that as a curator, you're presenting something as throne and asking the audience to deal with it. So let me back up.
No, but isn't throne an authority sign?
Well, I'm going to
break down. Okay, good, good.
So are you familiar with the work of Terzio Malaparte?
Yes, I am.
The cook goes Europe, right? And I would consider his situation where he has authority, but it's diminished because of where he is, that he constantly finds himself thrown into sometimes completely ghastly situations, right? But that he has to to then deal with them. And to some extent, your aesthetic and his aesthetic line up that way. No, you don't think so?
Not at all. I've read him, and he's a very interesting writer and a very disturbing one. He was basically a fellow traveler of fascism, having briefly been a fellow traveler of Lenin. He was a man who was an adventurer. He liked to put himself in extreme situations. He liked to study people that are truly horrifying. And he loved the kind of the sinister side of human nature and human events. He was a good but not great writer. The best of his writing is obsessive about the nastiest stuff you can think of. And in that way, a document of that stuff, there's nothing like it. I mean, he was a dinner table guest of Frank, who was the Gauleiter of Poland, who was one of the most horrid of the Nazi war criminals. So, you know, it's really interesting, but I don't identify with that at all.
Well, no. I see you don't identify with that politics at all. But the sort of situational position there.
I'm not trying to slam down what you're saying, I'm just trying to refine it a bit. To be a kind of situational person, I think we all actually are situational to a greater degree than we would like to admit, but to be a situational person is to say that you make out of your circumstances what can be done with your resources, with what's there, and so on and so forth, but the choosing of which situations you get into is all important. And his choice of situations was consistently bad. And my choice of situations has been pretty damn lucky.
Yes, you made better choices by far.
Well, sometimes they chose me, but I mean, in any case. Yeah. But I think one of the great powers one has is to say no to things. Opportunists are people who never say no. To respond to opportunity with a considered yes or no is something different. And I have seen myself in the latter role, but not in the former.
And then I think to bring it forward, a filmmaker such as David Lynch, yeah, and his sense of the throne. How would you respond?
David Lynch is a very interesting filmmaker, I think, and he has done some stuff that I love. Dune. I like a lot of what he does. I must say, after a while, I get a little weary of the dark side. I don't think the dark side is more true than other things. I think it is a truth, and I think people who shy away from it entirely are making a mistake, but I think those who get sort of caught in the headlights of the dark side, or whatever, I'm mixing metaphors here, but, Lonesome Highway, whatever. People who get fascinated by the dark side can find themselves succumbing to very, very dubious stuff, because morbidity is a kind of drug, pessimism is a kind of drug, cruelty is definitely a drug.
You're focusing on the darkness of these folks, yes.
Okay.
We need to move
on to another question, because this is going to turn into a second lecture. So.
Let me change gears and just say one thing. I'm a great admirer of Muhammad Ali. I'm a great admirer of Gandhi. I'm a pacifist pugilist. Yeah.
So just sort of staying on that for only a moment, what is the way forward with this idea? I feel like you've traversed this spectrum of the world of art with academia and museums and writing and making art, and you've probably had the experience of seeing all these things from all the perspectives that are probably possible, but there doesn't seem to be any sort of incremental move away from what's happening or what has happened. So how do you see the way forward?
Okay, I think there are definitely incremental moves. I'm 67, so I'm not that old, but I'm not that young anymore, and I've seen an awful lot of stuff happen since I was 17, which is when I sort of entered the world. And much of it's been pretty depressing, frankly. I think that the first thing is not to succumb to despair. The second thing is to realize that we are going to go through cycle after cycle after cycle of reaction, and that we have to know that reaction is no more powerful than other things. It is very powerful, but it is not automatically more powerful than other things. I think there are many reasons to be hopeful and even in some cases optimistic, given a situation which is presently so dire in so many domains. I also am aware at my age that it is really the younger generation that must get this thing up and going. My daughters are in their 20s and 30s. I will follow them. I will not try to lead them. If invited to do this, I will do it if I think it makes sense, and I will say no if I don't. But I'm not going to sit on the sidelines and, you know, be a sidewalk supervisor of another youthful rebellion. I did the 60s to the hilt. I think it is the turn of people to do the, what are we, in the teens to the hilt. But I do think that one has to learn from history. And I think one of the worst aspects of postmodernism is this assumption that you can't learn from history, that history is all just fictional, that it's all just ideological, that it's all just what you say it is. It's not. There are facts. There are good accounts and bad accounts, good answers and bad answers, good questions and bad questions. And I wish Americans would learn more of their own history. I wish they would really learn some detailed history of what goes on behind art as well as what's in art. I think probably the thing that I can do that would be most useful in this situation is to sort of develop some of these things in narrative form, because narrative history is better than theoretical history. People learn it better, people respond to it better. And as a narrative history writer, that's what I am as an art historian, I don't eschew ideology. I know what ideology is. I know the philosophical arguments as well as anybody else. I was in school in France when, you know, critical theory was becoming new. I know all that, so don't tell me that I don't know it. I'm saying to the people who also know it, wouldn't you like to change your rhetoric? Wouldn't you like to convey what you think and know to people in a form that they can actually take it in, digest it, and then argue it with you because you're probably wrong about half the time? And there's, on that score, one last thing. There's a quotation from Pessoa, Fernando Pessoa, who's a wonderful Portuguese writer, that I use as the epigraph for the book on modern art despite modernism, which was the show that I did at the Modern. And it was all the work in deep storage at the Modern, which was, at least according to critics of the 1980s and 90s, anti-modernist, reactionary, retrograde, horrible, horrible, horrible. And it's all this stuff, again, like Philip Perlstein, what makes him so terrible if you consider that he was, you know, onto Picabia long before October Magazine was. Anyway. So if Pessoa says in the context of all of this, he said, an idea is born, another one dies. Truth did not come or go, error changed. And I think if you think that your truth contains its own errors, that doesn't mean it's all relative. It isn't all relative. There are better and worse errors. There are better and worse partial truths. But you have to think along those lines rather than of a sort of definitive eclipsing of one ideology by another. And you have to get into the details. If you're going to write art history, you have to write about real art objects or images or processes. You have to write biographical criticism alongside theoretical long-term criticism. You have to do all of that at once, or else, you know, the temptations to sort of fudge things and clean them up are too great. Okay.
Had a request.
This is Emma Bovary, by the way, by Dorothea Tanning. This is in the collection of the Nelson Atkins that I bought. This is Venice Biennale. Oh, this is one of my favorite things. This is a block away from the Arsenale. This is the headquarters of the Italian Communist Party, the existing Communist Party. And on its outside wall is a niche of Christ and then the hammer and sickle flag. And inside are men of my age, roughly speaking, watching soccer under posters of Che. Now, if you want to look at the texture of, you know, communism in Europe, think about that. This is Sigmar Polka hiding behind one of his paintings. This is the ghost of the machine. This is me being paparazzied. This is me with Gilles Dorfles, who was an Italian critic, and he was 100 when this was taken. This is me with Ellsworth Kelly and Sherry Samba discussing Sherry Samba's painting, in which Sherry Samba surrounded himself with all the art that mattered to him. And you can see Magritte, Keith Haring, Picasso, Boetti, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This image, this painting, was put in the Arsenale, not the Arsenale, in the Italian Pavilion in such a way that it was the first thing you saw before you saw the work of Ellsworth, Gerhard Richter, Bob Ryman, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it was Sherry Samba, an African artist, putting himself in the middle of history, and I put this in the middle of the pavilion so everybody would understand that he was in the pavilion. Okay, this is Malik Sidibé, who is the first African to win a Golden Lion, and who was the first photographer to win the Golden Lion. And as it happens, I gave it to him. I mean, I made it happen. Oh, this is long time after. When I was doing the Biennale, my assistant, and I won't do too many things, I'm getting to the photograph. My assistant called me Don Storlioni. So I knew Bob De Niro's father, who taught at the studio school where I taught, and he called me up and asked, or his assistant called me up and asked me whether I would be willing to do something for a film that he was making on his father, who was a very interesting artist who was completely passed over by the art histories, having been once the top of the heap in 19-whatever. And so I said, sure, I'll do it. I said, the only thing I want, because I wasn't paying for it, the only thing I wanted the picture of the two of us together. He said, fine. So it's the first time I've ever asked for one of these things. So this is Don Corleone and Don Storlioni. This is Ellsworth in his studio, and this is Ellsworth with a thought balloon of his own shapes and paintings, and a photograph by me. This is his shovel, which looks like nothing so much as an Ellsworth Kelly. This is Carmen Herrera, who is 100, who knew Ellsworth and was rivalrous with him. She's a terrific artist, and the two of them were like this, okay? So she's now making art. Ellsworth, unfortunately, has died, but this is the continuity, and you'll see why I'm interested in this work. This is the continuity of certain kinds of abstract art, which were totally out of fashion, but they just kept on happening. This is me with her.
I want that t-shirt.
Oh, this is fun. This is a slide made by Elliot Arkin, a slide of me in my shirt. It's actually a Sculpey sculpture. Okay. This is a painting of mine from about 1980. This is that painting in an exhibition, and I forget what's in the background, but it had some kind of cool people in it. It was a show at the old Grace Borgonick Gallery. This is a painting that was in an exhibition that Fong Bui did, and this is a guy that you may know, Chuck Close, looking at it. These are some paintings I showed last year. These are some paintings that I showed in Seattle 3 years ago, and these are some paintings I showed at MANA a year and a half ago. So I've done a lot of other things, but that's what I've been doing lately.
Is there some place we can find your work online?
You can find it under my picture file if you look up, but I don't have a site. All of this, again, I didn't want to have my identity as an artist entangled in my role as a curator. I was very, very leery of being in exhibitions this whole time and had none. I gave things to benefit, principally to age benefits and so on and so forth, but a few other things to sell for their benefit, not mine. But I just wanted to keep it real clean, and I didn't want to sort of have people think that they could get to me by being interested in my work. I am, as I said, I don't believe we're all that modest. I'm not modest. I once said very immodestly, I want to be the best artist since Myron Stout to paint the least number of paintings. So that's my goal in life. And maybe I'll move to Denton, Texas to do it. Who knows? But anyway, so I am now going back to that life, and I probably will not be able to get rid of that man, you know, on the screen, but I'm going to do my best.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.